What a piece of junk.
Hi, and welcome back to Building the Millennium Falcon. We are part 9 at the moment. But first, a few words. As you might notice, I have changed the language. Now, the first episodes of this series I've done in Dutch. And the reason for that is because, in my opinion, there were enough English versions of this series already online on YouTube. So I thought, well, doing it in Dutch might be a nice idea. However, I got some advice or suggestions from my viewers requesting to go in English, because I have a lot of viewers from America and from the UK. So as a test, I'm going to do the first about four issues of this series in English. Now, if you have any other suggestions, just leave a comment below and I will address to them as possible. So I'll be doing this series in English for at least the next 3 to 4 parts. We'll see how far it goes, okay? Now, for those of you who have, of course, not followed this series because it was in Dutch, let me do a small recap of what I've done in the past months. My goal, my idea is to do a step-by-step review of the Millennium Falcon from D'Agostini. This series is not available in the Netherlands at this moment. I have, however, gotten a hand of this series. Each episode I take a look at the issue. In this case, we'll start with issue 9. I'll take a look at the parts included in the issues, and I try to construct each segment which is described in the issue as far as I can. But along the way, I'll be modifying the Falcon as much as I can, customizing it. There are several other customizing kits available online. I am trying to make my modifications as close to homebrew as possible, which means that I have to cut corners here and there. But I'll do my best as I go along. The best example, of course, is the cockpit which I have made. Maybe you can see it. I'll put it close-up link. I have changed the details on the side boards of the cockpit. I have also included, I've changed the height of the rear seats. I've already discussed this in earlier episodes. I also included a printed paper flooring for the floor of the Falcon. Whereas you normally can buy ready-made 3D printed floors which has panel lines. I made them myself. So this is my goal, to create a Falcon as much possible without any third-party customizing parts as possible. I will, of course, however, include fiber optics and lights as far as I can. So this is as far as I've got from issue 1 to issue 8. So now let's start with issue number 9. Issue number 9, Build them in the Falcon. What I always do, I start looking in the magazine and see what is in the magazine. Because, let's face it, these magazines, apart from giving you building instructions every week, you get actually a nice reading work about different areas of the Star Wars universe. In this case, we're going in Tentive 4, which is the Rebel Blockade Runner ship from the opening sequence of A New Hope. Nice little tidbit, of course, is that originally this ship was supposed to be the Millennium Falcon until someone at ILM saw an episode of the British TV series Space 1999 and said, oh dear, our Falcon looks a little bit too much like the Eagle One, let's change it. So they changed it into the famous half-eaten hamburger shape. More information concerning the Tentive 4. And which is also nice, they make little tidbits concerning the filming miniature, or in this case the filming set, which they used. Something about Tatooine. It's nice reading work. As far as I know, it's all canonical. So that's nice. Whole structure about the Falcon itself, now it goes, and here we have more information concerning details, and that they used hubcaps. And here we come to the green section of the magazine, which is the building. Now, for all, at this moment I have 50 magazines currently, well, about 41 at this moment, 41 magazines standby for filming. And in all cases, I have removed the magazines from their plastic bags, and have also removed the bags with parts from magazines, mainly because I needed a way to store them more easily. What I always do, I remove these cartons and then place it back in the bags, because in some cases the parts included in the kit or in the bag are not needed for this particular build at this particular moment. Sometimes it takes weeks or even months before you start using parts which are in these bags. So that's why I put these these cardboard things back, because they're all listed with a number, which will make them more easier to find. Now let's see what's in the bag at this issue. We got a little bag of screws, which you have to be very careful you don't lose them, so I'll put them back in this larger bag as soon as I can, including the cardboard, which I just said. We have a detailed section of the corridor ring, which I know I'm going to modify, and I will come back to that later. This is part of the main hold, a wall section, just a piece of plastic, but that will be fitted in the main hold later on. Two pieces of black stickers. I'll come back to that later as well, because I have no need for those. And pieces of the bottom hull and sections of the metal frame for the bottom hull. Also, which is at this moment, as far as I can see, not yet applicable for this episode. So I'll put these back in here as well. And the main thing we have here is a little box, which is a battery box, which can be used to test the lights of the Falcon during construction. At this moment, the only part which has lights is the cockpit, the main cockpit. So we can test if the lights work. Okay. Before going on, these stickers. These stickers are supposed to go on the inside of the cockpit. Let me show it on the. Here it is. These stickers are supposed to go on the inside of the cockpit tubes. I have a cockpit half here. I'm not going to use these. These are, of course, to prevent light leaks from the cockpit light. Because I've put much more lights in there than the original model has, I have decided to paint the inside black, which, as far as I believe, is a better solution on the whole. And here we have the bottom section of the cockpit, which is also painted black to prevent light leaks, not only from the main light in the back, but also from the several LEDs I'm going to place connecting these fiber optics cables. So, as far as I can see, let's see what else. We have to also place several details on the cockpit shell, outer shell, details which were already provided in earlier issues. Now this I'm going to fit upstairs in my main building office. So, one of the first things you need to do for issue 9 is checking if the lights work.
I have here the battery box. I have already placed in four AA batteries. And let's see if it works. If you can see, there are a lot more cables running at this moment from the cockpit tube than originally in the instructions are being shown. That's of course all doing extra LED lights, but let's just suggest that they're not there, those LED lights. And let's put in this cable, if it will let's put it the right way in, of course. And that's gonna be a bit difficult. Maybe it will work. There we are. Okay, we have a working cockpit light. Okay, so I know that this works. Anyway, the other cables, let me quickly show you what I've done. Hold on. Let me quickly show you what I've done. And here you are, it's a bit more color, a bit more light in a cockpit. Now I can't show you much more at this moment because it's all hooked on a cable which I can't pull up. Might try to move the camera. Give me a few seconds. Okay, so I've added a red light on the left. As you can see, there's also a light in the door which changes color, and there are several more of those lights changing color on the right in the back section, which is not very easy to see now the white lights are on, but they are there. And the cockpit also has some lights. Unfortunately, there's also a light leak currently in the floor section for the where Han Solo sits. I will try to fix this, but I'm not quite sure if I actually can reach it. But let me first switch off these lights as well. Now, in this bag, there is also included a separate wire, and even though I only have the magazines 1 to 50, I have checked the internet and I have learned what I suspected, that this cable is actually going to be the cable for the cockpit when it's all finished. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to remove the cable from the battery box very gently, not to damage any other cable. Okay, then I'm going to insert the permanent cable, which I won't be able to now connect to the battery box anymore, but that's not a problem. Because now I can actually close the gap in here, and this will prevent me damaging these cables, which are they're not really that fragile, but I would like to keep them safe as much as possible. What I am going to do is I'm going to insert this ring and the main cockpit shell, which I have already painted inside. I will not glue, which will so I can actually remove it later. In later issues they will be adding glass panels to insert, although I'm not quite sure if these will fit because all the additions I've done to the cockpit shell. And it might also, the original model in the studio did not have lights, did not have windows. So I'm not quite sure if we're going to do that. So, at least we know the lights are working and I can close this shell, this cockpit shell, and start working on the small details which were also included in issue 9. So, we're now going to add the details, the details on the cockpit tube, and they are suggesting using superglue. I do not have superglue. I have, however, used this before. It's model plastic from Bison. I'm not quite sure if this is available outside Europe, but this glue suggests that it works on plastics and ABS plastics, which as far as I know is the material this model is made out of. So we're going to use that. I already installed these items. Unfortunately, there is a spillage of solder right on the part where I was needed to find out where these two is going to go, but I believe I have it correct at the moment. And there are now three parts still need to be installed. These over here. And when you're familiar with model kits, you know that parts are numbered, and you can find those numbers on little labels on the sprue. Not in this case. There are no numbers on this sprue, except maybe for the number for which issue it's supposed to go with. This is issue number 9. Sprue, so that is correct. In order to successfully identify all the items or all the parts, you need to lay this sprue next to the photograph, and then you can actually see all these items are numbered. So you need to use the instructions carefully. Let's first dry fit this part. This is supposed to go over here, and supposed to go over here. So, that means I need two dots of glue, and instead of gluing the holes, I would like to glue the tips. And so this goes in that hole, and this goes in that hole, and let's just hope that this glue does what the label says, and the part will actually stay on. If not, I will need to purchase a bottle or a tube of super glue. Anyway, side note, I added some putty in this hole, which is supposed to be a blast hole. On the entire model, there are several blast holes on the Falcon, and they're already included in the model. However, they don't look very convincing as blast holes. They look more like just plain holes in the plastic. So what I did is add some putty and roughened up the sides a bit and use a soldering iron to burn sections of the edges off, so it looks a bit more like it's actually burned in. Alright, let me put it in. So in the hole. Okay. That's one. And the same goes for the other part. Now when this is dry and finished, I need to glue three other details on the top of the tube. But I need to wait, of course, until this is completely dry, because this glue might work on ABS, but it does require a little bit more drying time than super glue does. So, okay, yeah, I need to clean that up, but I need to clean up this mess. Okay, still working on the hold. As you can see, I've made some alterations. Now, for those of you who have just joined me in the English language, I have changed a few things about the floor of the hold. I've used paper, just plain paper, printed on a pattern of these tiles, floor tiles, and use varnish, so it's the paint will be the ink will be protected, and then added some like rust things and stuff like that on it. Use paper for this as well, because actually I wanted to have some kind of detail on that, and that misfired, but never mind. I just used spray paint to put on some metallic looking coat. Used a brush like the one you use to clean your glasses. It actually, it shines up like it's polished metal, exactly what I was trying to do. So I made some alterations. First of all, I have cut out these two. Can you see it actually? No, hold on, you can't see it. I have cut out these two sections because there are some cable details running in the original version, and I've used some styrene to made also some lip around it, a lip. It needs to be sanded a few times, of course. I've cut a hole in here that was actually supposed to be for the fiber optics of the bench, which is coming over here. But it turned out that it was much easier to just drill small holes in here, so all the fiber optics cables, which are quite stiff, can go through here. And what I'm doing now, I'm making a few slits and holes into this wall section. This is going to go over here, and the reason why I'm making these holes is because I have here the technical station, which I have added a lot of fiber optics cables. There are a lot more coming in later, and these need to go through this hole so it can actually stand. This wall is going to go over here, and the technical station is going to come over there. Now, I've seen on pictures that there's also a window-like thing over here, which I need to cut out, and oops, sorry, I just hit the camera. That was not a very smart thing to do. Anyway, where was I? So as I was saying, I'm going to leave it at that. This is as far as we go with issue number 9, episode 9. We're going to continue working on the hold with issue 10 and the cockpit. Let me show you this, because the cockpit is finished as far as I until all the parts have been glued into place on the bottom and at the top. As far as I know, the cockpit section is not going to be used until issue number 95, I believe. So we're going to put this away safely, because we probably will not be seeing this cockpit section again until the very end. And then, of course, we need to paint it again. But that's far in the future. So, cockpit's finished. That was issue number 9. Continuing on the hold, that will be issue number 10 and beyond. And see you next time.